Hey guys, it's Mitchell. I'm in Kirkland, Washington with John Sheehan. It's my buddy who picked me up from the airport, and we're in John's garage where we just unpacked the bike. And John is a bike manufacturer and also, I guess we could say, a master mechanic, right, John?
I've only been doing it for, 40 years, so I think.
Only 40 years? Oh, sorry. Years. But, yeah, so we figured we'd take a little video of his setup here and what he does typically to put a bike together after it's been in a case. So, John, tell everybody what you're doing here.
I'm just putting the rear derailleur on the bike here. I just put a little grease on the hanger there. I think one of the things when you take your bike out of the case, what's important is visual inspection. Just run through it, like I know you've got a couple of scratches here. So obviously, Mitchell, you need to focus on packing your carbon bike a little tiny bit better.
Not my strong point.
Not your strong point, but that's good. You have lots of good strong points. So we won't give you too hard a time. But hey, just a visual inspection and a little clean. When you take it out, I mean, I'm just anal about my bikes being clean. I like wash my bike every time I ride it.
Yeah.
That's not the way it used to be when I was racing, but now I kind of look upon my bike differently. But so just run through, just a little examination. This bike's...
And like, what's the most, what is it that you find in the exam? Like, why wouldn't you just put the bike together without doing that?
Oh, I always, like, one thing that I'm very anal about is brake blocks. I always want to make sure that the brake blocks are clean. I just, look what I use for cleaning my brake blocks. See this here, a little Stanley blade or DeWalt blade. I just clean in between, knock the stuff out.
Put those lines there?
Yeah, just... Any time, well, if you have a aluminium or aluminum, rims, you'll always find little bits of metal in the brakes, in the brake blocks. So you want to like clean them out. You ride carbon rims all the time, so you don't, but you just want to clean out in between
the
ridges. And that helps, you see all that like dirt. I've already cleaned them, of course.
Yeah.
So we're going to put the bike together. We're looking at it. It's dirty. We're going to give it a wash as well. Maybe we could do a little separate like thing on that.
Well, you know what I was thinking too, John, is I was having trouble shifting, and I wonder if the last time I packed the bike, this hanger got a little torqued.
Yeah, we can do that bit. Actually. That we can. There's no problem. We can have a little look at that. We can put a rear wheel in. And have a look at that. This is, for most people, this is a derailleur alignment tool, right? It's a really handy tool to have. And nowadays, derailleur hangers are actually designed, to be soft and break off. It's not like in the old days that are steel bikes where we could bend the hangers back and so forth, right? So, what we do is we put in our derailleur alignment tool. Okay.
Should I get the wheel?
Yeah, we'll grab it now in a second. Yeah, and...
This makes, I mean, I know that I've bent that in the past, and the bike will shift with a little bend in it, but it functions far, far better when it's aligned.
Yeah. I think we just discovered a little thing that your hanger, the threads are kind of like they're not like 100%, so I might replace them for you.
I mean, they're over tightened or?
Yeah, no, they're just like cross. You cross threaded it at some stage, so you can see here. I knew that because when I looked at the threads on the derailleur, you can see that they're like pretty snarled up there.
I don't know if I'm getting it with the camera enough. Yeah. Wrong way.
They're pretty snarled up there, those threads, right? They're not like nice, sharp, and fine.
Oh, okay.
You know?
Okay.
So when I saw that earlier on, that said to me, there's something wrong with that. So we just have a look. Let's see what it says to us with the... I'll throw a wheel in. Let me just throw a wheel in here.
Okay. John, tell us a little bit about these Gerard bikes.
Well, they're 4A T800 carbon fiber. They're very slippy, as we say. It means that they're very aerodynamic. That's the new thing nowadays in bicycles, right? I mean, that's everybody wants an aerodynamic bike because it just makes sense, you know? So that's they're aerodynamic. They're made overseas.
But when you were designing or you know thinking about putting this bicycle company together,
yeah,
what was it that made you to land on this particular mold? Was it the aerodynamics?
The aerodynamics? But really, if you take one of the bikes, right, this is the one I'm riding here, the blue one, right?
Let's see if I get a shot
and
of it.
If you
I'm
just
terrible with the gimbal here.
If you just look at it, the bike is somewhat, although it's a modern bike and it's aerodynamic, it somewhat reminds me of a traditional bike frame, like that. It's as opposed to say.
There's a black one here too.
Yeah, that one there. That's Mike Taylor's bike. You're one of the guys you coach, right?
Yeah,
that's his bike. That'll be ready in a couple of days. We're just waiting on
Taylor. Your bike's almost ready, dude.
So, well, the thing that I don't like about modern bikes is kind of the same thing that, you know, years ago when we first saw, like, you know, the big aluminium or aluminum tube bikes come out, like say like the Cannondales, like they just lost the beauty of the bike, you know. Yeah. And so
what are you doing, not to change subjects, but what are you doing now there?
So what we're doing here is we're basically measuring the plane that the derailleur is on, and it's obvious. So what we're measuring, I know that, you know, the derailleur hanger needs to be 80 millimeters all the way around the plane, and see here. Here it's 83. When we go around here, it is 75. So the derailleur is not in line. It's not in the same plane as the sprocket, so it's not going to
shift.
You know, it'll rub here or rub there. And the main reason for that is because in the old days, we had steel hangers, right? So when you bent it, you could bend it back, you could align it with the tool, like it was a little bit of a skill, but
yeah.
You're a good mechanic, you could do it. Nowadays, with the carbon frames, these derailleur hangers are actually designed to break, like you could piss on them and they'll break.
Wow.
Because that's what they're designed to do. They're aluminum, and they're thin, right? So they're designed to save the frame, they're safeguarding the frame.
Oh, okay.
Okay?
Yeah, that makes sense.
So they're soft. So you're out there, you know, you're parking your bike and you bang the derailleur off something. You know, it's easy to do and it's going to go out of alignment. So, you know, regularly, you know, basically it's just one of the things I do. When one of my ambassadors comes in, you know, we always like tweak, you know, all carbon bikes are the same. I don't care what you say. They're all, you know, they've all got aluminium, aluminum, hangers, and
they bend easily.
They bend easy. They're designed to, right?
Right.
That's the
right.
So I'm just like checking the.
Well, I have to say, this is my third trip to Kirkland visiting John in the last year and a half that we 2 years that we've known each other.
Yeah.
And in the last probably 16 months, I've been here 3 times. I always look forward to coming here for many reasons, but one of them is my bike gets completely overhauled.
it's like leaving
here with a new bike every time.
You don't want to own a boat. You just want to have a friend that owns a boat, and you don't want to have a bike shop or bike business. You just want to have a friend that owns it. I suppose that's it. But hey, You know, it's just, it's always fun. That's all I can say.
I think the coolest thing about this, one of the cool stories about this frame was this summer when we were on Martha's Vineyard. And our friend Mike Taylor, who actually is this black Gerard, is his bike. I built this, I was on my other bike, and I was, John, I've been an ambassador for Gerard for, well, about a year, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
But I hadn't actually built up the frame that John had given to me to ride. But since Taylor was coming to the vineyard too, John and then our friend Kenny, John said, hey, build up the Gerard so Taylor can ride it. And so I did, and then when Taylor got on the thing, he was absolutely flying down on the vineyard, on Martha's Vineyard. And I was like, man, I gotta build that bike up for myself and check it out. And it was super fast and it felt great. And then the other part of the story I wanted to mention that I started to begin with was the fact that Taylor ended up getting one too, and that's his bike. Is down
here, the black one here.
Yeah, it's the black one. I can't.
The new 9100 D82.
I can't get this gimbal to. It's that one, the black one, DI2. It's super awesome.
So what?
The same frame though, right?
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. All the frames are the same in all our models. So this gimbal, right? Maybe that's like, what about the ride that they have in New York, outside New York City? They call it the gimbals. Like,
I don't know.
I always think about that.
This thing is pretty cool. But anyway, so yeah, John started this bike business company. 2 years ago?
Yeah.
2 years ago.
Well, we've only really been selling bikes. It took us a couple of years to get the product right, you know, like to find the suppliers, the right suppliers.
Yeah.
So we've really only been selling the bikes in 2016. So 2017 is really our second year of production and sales. And so we're just loving it. We're having a good time.
And the bike show is next weekend?
Yeah, next weekend, the Seattle Bike Show. If anybody wants to come along, come along. And we're actually going to raffle a frame, you know.
Oh, cool.
So we're going to raffle a frame and all that kind of stuff. And we're going to have fun. We're going to have, like, Tim Rutledge there.
Tim Rutledge?
He's one of the...
Wasn't he a professional cyclocrosser or something?
He also he's one of the few people that rode and finished the Tour of Italy.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so Tim is the real deal. And Greg Orovitz is going there, 2-time US pro champion. Anybody that knows
anything about American cycling.
American cycling knows Greg.
John and I have had this debate. I think that of all the riders I've ridden with and that I know of, I would say that Greg is probably...
Yeah.
Probably the best rider, at least American rider,
that I've ever seen. Like Greg's on a bike. Just like one of the greatest bike riders ever. You know?
He's incredible. He's just
like
he's like Secretariat on a bike.
Yeah. You look at the website GerardCycles.com. I used to be Stephen Roach's training partner in Dublin back home the old days. He used to crucify me 4 hours, all that kind of stuff. It was just great. But I mean, Sean Kelly, I've raced, you know, I've ridden with a lot of good bike riders, but I mean, you know, for just, it's kind of hard to say. It's like for the average guy, Greg was the greatest, right? That's all I can say.
Yeah.
We have lots of good memories of the old days in France. Yeah. Like you'd be in a race, like, yeah, you were in the race, same race as Greg, but you were in a different part of the race.
Yeah.
Greg was in the break. And a lot of people were just hanging out.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know that he actually rode with Le Mans on Leclerc, was it?
No, ADR.
ADR
was, yeah.
And, you know, was just sort of quietly probably the most dominant American rider,
yeah,
at least in one-day races for many years. And
super bike rider.
And
super bike rider.
He just moved up here, just a few miles up the road.
Yeah, living in Bellingham. So it's great that, like, you know, to reassociate with old friends that you used to race with years ago, and he's
it's a great, small world.
It's a small the bike riding world is a small world. It's
I used
small
to train
world.
With Greg when he worked at Belmont Wheelworks in Massachusetts. We used to train out at Wachusett. and this is back in like 2004, 2005, and he hadn't been retired that long, and I was just fully into the amateur regional scene. So I learned a ton of, a lot about bike racing from him, and a lot about Eddie B. He does a great Eddie B imitation. It's hilarious.
No, no. When someone going very strong on front, strong like ox,
strong like bull,
strong like bull. But
yeah. Actually, do you know what I mean? When I think about it, like, yeah, I'm really gifted that, like, another one of my ambassadors, Bob Wade. Actually, Bobby. He's down in California right now.
I wish he was here, man.
God, like, you know, that's...
He's a beast. He's a beast.
Yeah, he's...
Like...
Yeah.
How many... Yeah, he's... Like, not only does he do volume, he does
lots of climbing as well.
And he's our age, right? He's...
Yeah.
He's a full, yeah. basically a full-time... He's like a surfing bum.
Yeah.
He's got a camper.
Except on a bike.
Yeah, he's got a camper, and he's... In California, they call him Seattle Bob. They just because he goes down to there. He goes down there for
three months
just to do group rides in Santa Barbara.
He's a stud, right?
He crushes the young guys.
Yeah. You're not trying to do. Not trying to crush. He's just so fast, right?
That's what he does.
Like just like you, right?
Lifestyle. Oh, thanks.
You know,
yeah, I don't know about that. I tried.
So it was kind of cool. So
you're working on getting the handlebars back?
Yeah, we're just like getting your headset. I think we're going to look at your headset. You know, you said it was making a little noise, so it probably just like needs a little bit of like tender love and care. You know?
Yeah.
That like we don't. It's okay for you like not to look after your bike that well, seeing as you go so fast. But like if you don't go fast. You better look after your bike, okay?
Right? That sounds a little snarky. Yeah. So in the day, John was an Olympic caliber rider, right? Tell the folks about your background.
I was the most worthless bike rider that could win a bike race. I was a good sprinter. That's what I was. I was just a good sprinter. Just like I was strong, big legs, you know.
But yeah, but come on, tell them. No, you pretty much you won a lot of races in the United States.
Oh yeah, I won
Super Week and those
sorts. I won some good races. Like I raced for the Toga Bike Shop, in New York City. Who I love, Lenny.
Oh yeah, of course.
Lenny was just the gentleman of all gentlemen. Took a chance on us, and we won. I won like.
Who else rode on Toga? I can think of.
George Hincappy, like he was only a kid. He was
and Richard, right?
17 Hincappy. Or 18, yeah. Yeah. God, he was like so fast. He was such a.
Didn't Hamilton ride off for Toga as well?
I don't know. Not when I was there, but we had Nelson Vales. Nelson Vales, like, you know.
I heard of him.
Who else? Kidding. We had lots of, like, you know, good guests. Right? Julian Dalby, my buddy Julian Dalby, was really the two of us. We went over there together, and it was all just
great, man. You know, it's, you know, we were giving it a shot. You know, I see a lot of...
So Julian Dalby he was an Irish national road champion,
yeah.
And you were second in the year he won. And then he won a bunch of other stuff, and then he went on to do lots of things. He became a doctor, but... why don't you tell him about what he's doing now?
Well, he's actually Conor McGregor's coach. He's actually his coach.
Conor McGregor, for those of you that don't know, is the number one MMA fighter in the world right now. Mm-hmm. Just dominates. So he's...
Conor's good. You know, Conor's, you know, he's a nice guy. Conor's actually from the same street in Dublin as I am. That's why.
Where's that?
It's in Crumlin, in Dublin.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we kind of.
I gotta go to Ireland with you, man.
We have to go. Anybody wants
gonna,
to go? Listen,
we're gonna do the tour.
You want to have a good time bike riding, eating like good food, playing a little golf? You go to Ireland, man. Culture and bike riding, it's got it all. Trust me. Fun.
Yeah.
You know, there's great places in the world. My new greatest place is Italy. I've been twice. I did the Gran Fondo Fausto Coppi. last, what was it, September, yeah. Almost killed me. The hardest thing I've ever done, the only time I've ever walked up a hill on a bike, I actually had to walk.
Yeah, you told me.
Oh my God, so, but then I am 240 pounds. Anybody knows how I can reduce weight, tell me, besides like starving myself.
So John raced at 180 pounds.
Yeah, that's right. 180, and that was still, I was still too big at 180. I was still big. I needed to be like 170.
So, one of the most fascinating conversations I've had with John recently was we're talking about FTP and increasing functional threshold power.
Yeah.
And I was sharing with him some of the, you know, the latest science that a lot of the coaches are following today, which, you know, the zones and this sort of thing. And then you said to me that, he goes, I don't know about all of that, but what was the college in Ireland?
Oh, Trinity said, College. When I was on the Olympic squad, they used to test us down in Trinity College, you know, on the ergometer, I think it was called
Trinity College in Dublin.
In Dublin,
right?
Yeah. So in the sports lab, you know, and around it, you know. So the doctors down there, so it was very interesting things like that they used to tell. One, and these were like,
And what year was this, John?
Jesus.
83, 84?
No. It was 1990.
Oh, 1990.
Yeah. 1990. Okay. Yeah. So I was shortlisted. I was shortlisted for the Barcelona Olympics. Yeah. So I got hurt. You know, got run down by a car. You know, all that kind of stuff.
You got run down by a car.
I don't like to dwell. We don't like to dwell on the past, but like the facts are the facts, right? You know. We put it behind us. We try and work through it. But the doctors, you know, they talked to us about, you know, threshold, or as they used to call it, OBLA, onset of blood lactate.
OBLA.
Yeah.
What is it again? Sorry?
Onset of blood lactate acid.
Yeah.
You know, and they used to say, like, well, your OBLA is, you know, like, at, you know, I remember mine at the time was 343 watts was what they pegged it at, right?
Yeah.
That seems very small. We always talk about this now that, like, that seems very small compared to all the numbers nowadays, but I think that you and I are on the same page. We don't believe the numbers nowadays. Everybody, like, talking about, oh, my threshold is 400 watts, all that kind of stuff.
And today people train for the test, and that's just you coming off the road, getting tested.
That's just coming, and, you know, getting ready for the season, being tested.
And most people's threshold is, it's not, they don't race at their tested threshold. You know, it's just, you can't maintain it that high. And plus, lots of the equipment they're using, I don't think are...
Yeah.
I mean, there's definitely some power meters that are a lot stingier than others.
That's the word we use, stingy, right? So I've got my, actually, because you're in town, right? You're going to do a test. You're going to help me with my test.
Yeah, John's going to do an FTP test.
I got my tax there, and I'm going to do a test to help, because I'm kind of, I don't want to say I'm on a comeback, but with your help, I'm going to try and, like, lose a bit of weight and do a bit more, you know, get focus on training a little bit. I'm the kind of person, I'm either focused or I'm totally unfocused.
Yeah, on or off.
So I'm on or off. So I'm trying to focus a little bit, hence I had a salad for lunch.
Before we get too far down that road, so the John's going to do an FTP test this afternoon, and that's super awesome, just to have a baseline to build a program from for your goals.
Yeah.
But my point is that in 1990, there was no such thing as FTP. It was this onset of...
OBLA, onset of blood lactate acid.
And to increase that, the prescribed workout was...
That the doctor said, the doctors, the, I think they're physiologists or something like that, they call them. They said they recommended that we get 2 hours a week at or just underneath their threshold. That's what they said, you know. You guys need to be doing 2 hours a week at or below our threshold. Right. And when they said below, they didn't say very, very much lower. They were like, you need
just
to be
under
2 hours just underneath threshold. So that would have been, for me at the time, that would have been 2 hours a week, you know, somewhere in the 325, 325, 335, 345, something like that. you know, which at the time to me seemed like, you know, how the hell can you do that? Like, you know, threshold was like, you know, anyway. But right. we did it, you know, we did our intervals and,
yeah,
you know.
Well, the thing that's I really like about that story is, you know, so many of the coaches today, you know, they talk in terms of FTP that like Dr. Kogan or whatever, Andy Kogan invented it, you know, and that sweet spot training is something that's relatively new. You know, we're talking about basically the same thing with a different title that we all knew back in 1990.
Yeah.
And it still holds true today. If you can put in an hour and a half to 2 hours a week, you know, in that zone, you're going to go faster, period. Yeah. You know, yeah, it's not really fancy. It's just how do you break that up so that you can get it in and still be, you know, enjoy what you're doing and I'll make it to the races.
I think Mitchell, you and I were on the same page. Like, I'm a qualified cycling coach, just like, you know, you actually helped me, and I actually, Dr. Dalby has helped me a lot. That's where I've learned a lot of my stuff from. Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. He's an unbelievable, world-class person. But I think we're on the same page when, like, if you want to go faster on a bike, you have to learn to go fast first, and learn to go fast for a lot. Then you learn to stretch it out.
Right.
You got to get up to like bunch speed, group speed.
Right.
And then you got to work on it.
Stretch it out. My arm's getting tired.
That's yeah. Fine. Well, actually, Johnny Brady, a friend of mine, he was a pro for 7-Eleven, won a lot of good races. Mm-hmm. You know, whatever, Manhattan Beach Grand Prix, all these like great crit, you know, historic American crits, you know.
Yeah.
And I met him one time in Sacramento. I hadn't seen him in years. I was coaching MSU, Midwestern State University cycling team.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, I was a coach there for 2 years.
Cool.
But I met him in Sacramento and I said, "Hey, Johnny, hey, are you, you look good? Are you doing a lot of bike riding?" And he says, "Oh my God, I'm doing so much training." I said, "So what are you doing?" He says, "I'm doing an hour and a half every 2 days."
And he was right in that zone.
And he was flying, right? He was doing the river ride in Sacramento and like killing everybody. And his idea of, you know, he had finally learned that, like, the best thing to do is to, you know, do a lot of, you know, not a lot, but, you know, very intensive work, right?
Yes.
You know, not hours and hours and hours on the bike, not 20 hours a week on the bike.
But long duration at threshold, is that, or?
Yeah, like, do your intervals, go hard, right?
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It's like when we go to the gym, we do our work, we recover, and then we try and do a little bit more work. Right. We have progression in our
supercompensation.
Supercompensation. Yeah. We're trying to bring on supercompensation. That's what you're trying to do in training, as opposed to what a lot of people, old school training stuff does, is like ride yourself into the ground. And, you know, it just doesn't work, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's different, like, for the likes of, you know, Peter Sagan, Fabio Cancellara, all these guys. They need massive amounts of training, but they have got themselves to that level.
Right? Yeah.
They have themselves to the level where they can do 15, 25 hours a week.
Right.
And the other thing about it is conditioning is so important. Condition is the most important thing. Like, you know, they are in such good condition. They're world-class athletes, and then they're bike riders. That's the big change in cycling now, right? There's no fat cyclists. You know, the days the days of, you know, we talked to, you know what I'm saying? It's about conditioning, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I tell people, like, oh, you want to go faster on your bike, lose weight. That's the most important thing you can do. That's if they're overweight. Most people, if you're 12% body fat, if you get yourself to 10, you're going to climb better, feel better, go faster, recover quicker. That only might be like 6-8 pounds, right?
Yeah.
You know, and the interval train, you know, and do not a lot of training, but more focused training.
Yeah, definitely.
You know?
So, John, I know we've got to finish doing this and then also set up for the test.
Yeah,
and then we're
going
to go to the cafe to get some coffee.
We're going to get a little coffee before the test.
Say hello to the friends, the your friends down there.
That's it.
So we'll wrap this up. We'll be back with some more talk with John as we move along. I'll be here all week, so probably doing a number of blogs. So if you get anything out of this, you get any insights, please subscribe to the channel in the bottom right. John, we'll check him out later, right?
Good talk to you.
All right.
Take care.